everybody, welcome to the Let's Play. Today we're going to take a look at Warhammer Age of Sigmar Skirmish, which is a cheap little supplement that you can actually do some skirmish size games in the Shadespire territory, which is the giant ancient city that's been unlocked in the Realm of Death, the Realm of Sheish, I believe it's pronounced. This is the where Nagash lives. No, it was the...
It's
the,
all gone.
Sheish was the Wind of Magic too, remember? It was the name of the Wind of Magic in 8th edition, so that would be something that you would know. It's all gone. You just deleted it? You just dumped that whole folder?
It all burned down.
He dumped the entire Warhammer Fantasy folder in his brain.
It's
just out.
There might be a photo album somewhere.
Some directory names, but there's nothing in them. So we're going to be trying that out. It's basically a 6-mission campaign supplement where you go from a hero and his, like, buddy... And then you build, and that appears to be the case, because we tried building a couple warbands. It's very hard to take more than like 4 or 5 guys when you start off, to building a warband, basically, like you recruit more dudes, and then you have a final showdown. So what really matters is the last mission, the 6th mission in this little campaign, and we'll go back and forth between our channels, showing this off. And then you basically are recruiting dudes all the way through, and the minimum recruits you usually get is 6, so you start off with renown points. Even if you lose a game, you take 6 renown home with you to recruit more guys.
With
and if you win,
more.
That's right, yeah. With like bonuses for the mission
and
stuff.
Rerolls and all that kind of stuff.
And all kinds of other bonus, and you get artifacts and stuff too. And then 10 when you get a major victory. So you're basically, you're incrementally increasing your warband size. If you go back and forth in victory, you should be pretty balanced by the end. And then your hero is getting artifacts and learning skills. And they set up not unlike regular battle plans in Age of Sigmar. So we'll walk you through the warband creation, which is basically the only complicated part. It's the only thing that's different from normal Age of Sigmar. We'll show you the battle plans and we'll get started. Here's the book, Skirmishes in the Age of Sigmar. And it does most of the overview stuff like in the beginning. About mustering your warband, and they're telling the story of what's happening. So, Myrtle Realms, what's happening in Shadespire. So Shadespire is this big ruin that's been unearthed in Sheish, which is in the Realm of Death. Giant glass towers, all kinds of craziness. And the people are all, it's basically a Mordheim setup. People are all doing a gold rush to go and try and unearth its secrets. And we get our skirmish rules. So, skirmish battle plans, warbands are a bit later on, skirmish formation. All models are individuals as opposed to being units. So when you fight guys that are within range of you and base to base with you. It's regular Age of Sigmar, but instead of having units that operate as units, every dude is his own dude. Allegiance abilities, every warband owns allegiance to one of the orders. And of course you get allegiance abilities from the General's Handbook. In skirmish battles, your warband can only use the allegiance abilities of the Grand Alliance from which they hail. The general, you have to have a hero to lead your army, so I have my Lord Celestin here, who's on a mission. There's a free guild,
General
on, yep. On Warhorse with a great weapon there, double-handed weapon. And they have to be, you have to take one. So your starting warband, which is 25 renown, you have to have one of these guys. You don't use the normal rules for battle shock in this case, because every unit is its own unit. If you suffer casualties anywhere in the forest during the turn, you make one battle shock test for the whole warband. And then if you, however much you fail by, you pick who comes off the warband, who like chickens out and flees. So not going to be a super big deal in the beginning because like we have like 2 guys. So we'll make one battle shock test the entire game. Yeah, really. Like your jobber might die and then the general just goes bye-bye and just like leaves, but it's unlikely that's going to happen.
From the field.
Yeah. And then sometimes a spell ability, I mean, sports are like to add god models and stuff like that. However, in skirmish battles, they never work. So no summoning at all in skirmishes. 3 rules of 1 from General's Handbook are in place. So each spell can only be cast once per turn. Hit rolls, wound rolls, and save rolls of 1 always fail after rerolls. And the third one, any extra attacks, hit rolls, wound rolls cannot generate extra things. So those are in play. Command abilities. You've got your base command abilities, artifacts of power, and mysterious terrain, which we'll use for this, specific skirmish. And then, the campaign rules. So, starting a campaign, you play these 6 missions, Clash of Dawn, Treasure Hunt, Fragile Cargo, Vortex Power, Assassinate, and Seize the Relic. And then it's the usual victory conditions, so major, minor victory or major, minor defeat. And then you've got the underdog bonus, your difference in renown will give you rerolls that can be used for casting rolls, run rolls, hit rolls, save rolls, battle shock tests, unbinding, charge rolls, wound rolls, and damage rolls. And between games, you roll on the rewards of battle, earn and spend renown, and that's all on this table right here. So if you win a major victory, you get 10 extra renown, minor is 8, draw is 7, loss is 6. Any renown warband earns can be spent immediately or banked, and then your casualties always come back when you die. So no, there's no injury table, this is not Necromunda or Mordheim. This is more like the Warhammer Skirmish supplement from the General's Compendium and White Dwarf from the early 2000s. It's a way of playing light campaign narratively driven games of Age of Sigmar. Towards the battle, you got a 2d6 table here for all kinds of cool things, like a fortuitous trinkets, warding glyphs, protected from magic, healing elixirs, get some wounds back, all kinds of neat stuff. And then this is where your stuff, like where you get extra renown stuff comes to. So like there's a heroic saga, your general's reputation grows, you earn d3 extra renown. So there are ways apart from winning and losing to get renown. If you're a wizard, there is three different Shade Spire special spells they can learn for the campaign as well. Twilight Path, Shard Mist, and Soul Siphon, and you can choose to roll on that table instead of the regular wards of battle if you have the wizard keyword. This is the storyline for the six different missions, and then you can do it as match play as well. There's some rules here for doing like match play battle plans for like little pickup games and or tournaments of skirmish. Battle plans: Clash of Dawn, which is the first one we're gonna play today, Treasure Hunt, Assassinate, Seize the Relic, and pretty pictures of pretty GW terrain and pretty miniatures. More pretty pictures, and then choosing warband stuff. So, choosing warbands, you have 25 renown to begin with. All models have to be from the same Grand Alliance, but you can mix all the keywords and stuff. Your warband must include a minimum of 3 models, which is funny because neither of us have done that. I actually don't think it's possible for me to do that unless I take somebody who's not a Stormcast Eternal.
I will do it.
You'll have to do it.
I'll make a real team.
I'll see if I can make a real team too, but I'll pick somebody else.
Scoop guys from
order. Other order, yeah. And then your minimum, you have to have one hero. So like my cheapest Stormcast guy, I think is, if I take a Knight of Zero, so it's going to be 16, but I don't want painted. So I have to find some 2-point dudes that are order. Ignore all the minimum War Scroll sizes. You can choose any combination of weapons from War Scroll. So guys can have like, let's say, halberds or swords and shields. You can have a mixture of them on the War Scroll. You only include each War Scroll once. Each model can only take a champion once, for instance, and then your warband can never incorporate any battalions. Also, special weapons are still limited by model count, so like my Grand Hammers and Great Blades in my library, and I still have to have 5 guys per one. So you have 2 little swordsmen, there you go!
Yep.
Yeah!
You have a spare point now.
And they're 2 points each, now you have a spare point banked. Alright, so change of plans, because I didn't realize I had to have 3 guys. I'm now playing Chaos! So my 25 renown I've spent on an Exalted Deathbringer, and he's the one with the big axe thing and the stab in hand. And then I've got 2 Nightrunners with stabbing blades and slings, and 2 gores. There's a champion Nightrunner and a champion gore. So what's kind of cool about this game is I literally just went and said, what has the chaos keyword in my like random round-based miniature collection of fantasy models? And that was my Skaven Mordheim warbands and my Skaven Beastmen warbands and my gore chosen guys. And lo and behold, I have a chaos warbands. And then Owen's taken an Empire General and 2 Free Guild soldiers.
Guard,
with swords and shields.
Free Guild Guard
with swords and shields. And you just fill that out on a thing over here. So this is in the back of the book, the little roster sheet. So Ash, Allegiance Chaos, Exalted Deathbringer is my general. His renown cost is 16. He starts off with his Brutal Command ability. And you can also roll or choose one from these command abilities. Because unfortunately, when everyone's a unit of 1, some of the command abilities don't make a lot of sense. So they give you the option of some custom-made ones for this specific type of game. And I rolled Reserves of Courage, so once per game, he can add 2 to his bravery and making a battle shock test if somebody dies. And that's going to be a bigger deal for me than for you, because I have a lot more guys to lose than you do. So it's going to be a little more battle shocky as I roam the waste. I assume this guy got, like, knocked out during a fight and woke up wandering the deserts in the realm of death, and he's just been collecting the other people that, like, are under the Dark God's banner, and he's just leading them on, and they're following around because he brings them food. Set up the Clash at Dawn. So we've chosen our warbands. It's a 4x4 battlefield, and you set it up as using the normal rule sheet from Warhammer Age of Sigmar. Both players roll a die, rolling a tie. The players alternate setting up models one at a time, as described below. If one player finishes first, the opposing player puts down the rest of their models, and the player finishes setting up first, chooses who goes first in the first battle round. So, Fog of War. Battlefield is divided into 4 quarters. Before each model is set up, you must roll a dice to see which, and consult it for which quarter of the battlefield they have to be set up in. So, basically it's 1, 2... 2, 4, assume this is supposed to be a 3. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And if a 5, 6 is rolled, or if it's not possible, set up a model in that quarter. The player may choose which quarter that model is set up in. Models that may not be set up in area marked no man's land, so within 6 inches of the middle, but they can be deployed anywhere else that's wholly in that quarter and more than 9 from any enemy models. Any models that can't be set up are reinforcements and arrive later. You can bring any reinforcements onto the table in the movement phase, place them within 3 inches of any edge, and 9 from enemy models. Reinforcements that have not arrived start showing up during the third battle round. Or sorry, that don't arrive by the start of the third battle round are counted as slain. So, Break of Dawn. In the first battle round, line of sight is limited to 12 inches. Models may only shoot, charge, and use abilities and spells up to that distance. In the second battle around, this effect is increased to 18 inches. Basically, the sun's coming up over the Realm of Death. And this effect ends at the end of the second battle round. Victory, you don't use the normal victory conditions. The game ends at the end of any battle round in which at least one player's warband has been broken. Warband is broken if more than half of its models have been slain or fled. If at the end of the game one player's warband is broken, the general has been slain. Their opponent wins a major victory. If one player's warband is broken but the general is still alive, they get a minor victory. If both players' warbands are broken, the result is then a draw.
Boy.
Three, got a two. So you get to put the first model down. So you roll a die. And then it's one, two, three, four, and then 5, 6, and choose.
Swordsman Captain.
One. It's going to be in there. Some mysterious rules for this creepy skull and the two realm gates as well to see what they are before we finish deploying. So this is going to be a four, which is crumbling. Roll a dice each time when your model runs charged within 1 inch. On a one, the feature collapses and you remove it from the board. That's hilarious. Skull. It's going to be cursed. In your hero phase, roll a dice for each of your models within 3 inches of this terrain feature. On a one, they take a mortal wound. Yeah, that makes sense. Don't go near the giant screaming skull thing. And then this over here is going to be four. It's also crumbling. So the gates are falling apart. And don't go near the crazy screaming skull in the middle of the table in the Realm of Death. I got a rat. Let's see where he goes. I roll a 5, 6 so I can choose. I'm going to have my rat hang out over here. Swordsman. 5, 6, you can choose.
He'll hang out with his friend.
Cool. Man. It's going to be a two. So 1, 2 is going to be over here. Hanging out in this quarter. And the boss. Gonna be two. Uh-oh, 9 inches away from me. First score, it's gonna be in a four, so he'll be over here. Next score is gonna be in a three. So he's gonna be over here, hanging with his buddy, Mr. Nightrunner. And then Mr. Exalted Deathbringer. 5, I can choose. He'll hang out with his friends over here. Ready to rock and roll some damage. You can choose who gets first moves in the first battle round. It's going to be you. Now, I, before the first turn goes, get to make a move with my gutter runners as they do their skittering advance. Have them run before the first battle round starts, and then you can choose who goes first because this is part of deployment. So this guy's going to go 13 inches.
Yeah, this might change
that. Yeah, I was going to say. He's going to go party over here. Like that. He's going to run and go 11 inches. Yeah, he's going to go over this way. So 8, whoop, and then 2, and just be on the other side of it. So right there. Decide who wants to go first and who wants to go second.
I'll go first.
You go first? All right. So first in the first battle round. So hero phase, command abilities. Command abilities. So
charges or
not? On the movement.
This guy is going to, or do we move first?
You move first, you move and charge in the same turn.
Oh, okay. Then these little guys are going to go. They walk 5.
And they do. And they have to stay outside of 3. That's the engagement bubble they're charging.
He walks 12.
What? So,
eight.
Clop, clop.
4. Magic, so we're just going to try and charge you.
All right, so rolling for that little guy. He'll make it for sure. In he goes. Into base to base. Yeah, next one.
He's in.
12 definitely makes it. Remember, you can charge anybody. So if you want to go a different direction, you can.
I've already moved him.
Okay. And the boss?
7.
Yes, he goes within 1/2 inch. He's fine.
Cool.
Yeah, because it's just 1/2 inch for engagement. Or for finishing a charge, sorry. Your engagement's probably actually further than that. General go first and do his fight.
Yep.
All right.
He attacks with his great weapon.
All right, hitting on.
3s.
3s to hit.
Hits 1, 2. Twice. And then wounding on 3s.
Uh-oh. 2
wounds. Red and minus 2, and each does D3 wounds.
So I got a 6 plus save. So guess what? I'm dead. You do 8, 5 wounds. He is an unscathed. The two don't get to pile in because no enemies within 3 inches now, and that means it is over to me in the next battle round. Hero phase, rather. So I will be making a battle shock test this turn. I don't like that, so I'm going to use my reserves of courage for +2 bravery just to make sure I don't go away. Here's some movement. We're starting off with this little gutter runner. He has a special rule where he can actually run and shoot in the same turn, so he's going to take a run. And he only goes 8, which is pretty super crazy fast still. Oh, jeez. Let's not get too near that thing. Over there. Who's going to run? Al Gore. Yeah. 6, he's going to go 12, so 8. And then 4 more. Keep up with his friend. Mr. Beasterman's not going to charge.
Oh, come fight.
Yeah.
It's going to happen. You're going to lose some
people. Yeah, he's going to go. I know. Everyone lives. We die. We live. We die. We live again. We got 6 over here. Mr. Exalted Deathbringer is going to go 5. Whoop. And wind up just behind the gore. Hanging over here. Being ready to stab you with the stab-ma-jigs. Well, we've done our movements. We have a single Skaven who can fire. I think he only chucks his throwing stars or sling around at 12 inches, but let's just chuck.
Pretty sure you can only see 12 inches on the first turn anyway.
You can, yeah, until the sun comes up, but I can shoot 12 inches, so I think I'm within 12. We're going to throw some throwing stars into your Generali, and he gets 2 attacks, hitting on 4s, winning on 5s, damage 1, no rend. So 2 attacks, hitting on 4s. That was great. Some charges. I'll start with the Exalted Deathbringer. See how far he gets to go. He's going to go 11. He's going to go charge like, yeah.
So you can fight both these little dudes.
And then we're going to roll for the gore. And he's only going to go 3, and he's going to fail. We're out. You're doing great, Mr. Gore.
Does he move anyway?
No, he doesn't move at all. Oh, okay. His job was to go this way, so that when you piled in, you had to pile in that way. Now I have to kill your general. I only have one choice. Let's see if we can stab you. I hit on 4s, wound on 3s, run minus 1. So I've got 3 attacks. Ha! Hit on 4s, only 2 hits. Wound on 3s with my ruinous axe. Wound twice, rend minus 1. Damage 2.
5 plus.
Ha! Makes one. Fails once. He's going to take 2 wounds.
Down to 3.
Anyway, general, can hit me back.
Yep. He's going to swing his hammer. Hitting on 3s.
1. Wound I like it threes. So far.
2.
And then what's your damage?
Red minus 2. It does D3.
Okay, red minus 2, D3. So I can't actually roll a 6, because if I roll a 6, it becomes a 4 because you're minus. But a 6 plus will save. Nope, don't make it.
D3. You take 2.
2. Blah. And I've got 3 left.
4 plus. Right, 4 plus.
Uh-oh.
No mod.
Okay, well now if I roll a 6, I need 3 mortal wounds.
Oh, nope. Mortal wounds.
And I make a save, though. 4 plus.
Okay.
So Bleeder's going to pile in and stab me.
So he gets 2 attacks because he's in charge. 4s. And 4 again.
Nope.
I think they re-roll.
4s. Nope. All right. Well, I've survived. You've survived. We've both got 3 wounds left. This battle round, top of 2. I have to make a battle shock test. At the end of this round, actually, and my battle shock is going to be 1. My bravery on Exalted Deathbringer is 8. 9, 10 right now, so I can't possibly fail. I'm good. And that's going to take us into the second battle round. So now it's initiative. See who's first. And...
Oh, it's a roll. Okay.
It's a roll. It's you.
Sweet.
So you take the first step in this second battle round.
I'm going to use my hold the line to pick 3 units.
Okay.
Can't run or charge. I'm going to pick these 3.
Obviously.
But they get plus 1 to all their hit and to wounds.
Cool.
Until my next hero phase.
Amazing. And is it other or can you include himself?
15.
Then you can pick yourself, absolutely.
Yep.
So plus 1 to hit and wounds.
And then he's going to shoot you.
Okay.
It doesn't.
Pistol. Six. Hits.
2 plus to wound. Wounds.
Wounds, and then rend.
Minus 1.
5 up. We're good.
Okay.
Shpang. Anyone else shooting?
They don't have militia.
Okay, no charging, so pile in with your boss.
He's in melee.
Hitting on 2s now.
Wounding on 2s.
Alright, save minus 1, minus 2. Here we go. Gonna need to make some 6 ups. I make 1, fail 2, so roll...
2d3?
2d3, 1s and 2s. Ah, I'm dead.
5.
Alright. And yeah, you can't move or charge, and that'll stop your pile-ins because everybody's already piled in. So that's the end of your half of this battle round. It's over to me. Uh-oh. Get him, boys. You can't get within 3, but you can walk over here.
Focus. Snakes always fail.
That's right. Snakes always fail. He's going to go 6. Whoop, over to here. And then he's going to go 7.
Get right in there with that.
Just go assassinate. Some guns. I'm going to try and shoot one of your... Actually, I'm trying to shoot your boss with my slings again. 4s. Double hits, 5s to wound. Nothing. Charge, first score. It's gonna go 3 exactly, which will get the one guy. Yep.
Yep.
Ha! Second gore.
I think he needs like a 5.
He needs something.
4 or 5.
He needs a 5. Will do it. Yeah.
That's 6.
So I have to go fight the boss. And we'll go over this way.
If you wanted.
No, thank you. And then a big roll for you, Mr. Skaven. Go big rolls. Nope, no one's going big rolls today. And we'll go fight this militia. We'll go fight your boss, why not? Brat. You can divide up your attacks. I will choose to go with my... this guy. My gutter runner sergeant. So we get 2 attacks, 4s and 4s, 6s to wound or minus 1 rend. 4s! Doing great, picky in it. I know you are.
So my general's gonna go.
Okay.
He's gonna put... I have to divide all of my attacks.
Yeah, divide them up against guys with an inch. Yep.
We're going to do 2 hammers against that guy.
Okay.
And 1 against the other one.
Sounds
and then
good.
A horse for each.
Yeah.
So the big hammer. Oh, wait, no, I don't need to do this. I'm hitting on 2s with everything. We'll put the horses all into little guy.
Okay.
2s on the gore.
Yeah.
And 2s.
You then got him, too. You do a bunch of wounds to him. He's exploded. Time.
Yes.
Hits.
Yes.
Wounds. I'm dead.
D3.
Yeah. I'm gonna kill that militia dude. There we go. That's my not gore sergeant. He's got a gore blade. 4s and 4s. Hits. Wounds, make a save there, swordsman.
Okay.
I'm gonna kill somebody.
He has a sword and shield, so I get plus one to my saves.
Yep.
And I can reroll saves of one.
Yep.
So I need a four.
I didn't need that. Both make battle shock tests. I have a
friend piles in.
Oh, his friend piles in. That's right. Three. He gets to go.
And then he'll swing his sword.
Fours.
Threes.
Threes. That's right. Nope.
Good job, buddy.
All right. So I'm bravery five right now, and I've lost three dudes this turn. I got to roll a one or a two. Ha! Nope, I'm gone. What about you?
I'm bravery. Oh, now it's locked.
Seven?
Can't get in.
You'd find it's only a five, yep. Free guild, you managed to clear the zone. So that's going to be a major victory for... Because
you killed your general, right?
Because you killed my general, that's right. Because you killed my general and you were unbroken. Rewards of victory time! So first you have to roll on the rewards of battle table. Roll 2d6, see what you get.
Seven.
Seven, it's going to be heroic saga, d3 extra renown. So you get 10 plus...
One.
So 11 renown. Also get to go on the rewards of battle. I stagger off with four healing elixir. So my general can heal D3 wounds suffered earlier in that battle. In a hero phase. I'm going to get 6 renown for having played the game and lost. So after my hiring, spending my big 7 renown, because I had 6 from the game and 1 saved, I've hired a Chaos Warrior. It's an aspiring champion from a unit of Chaos Warriors, so with double hand weapons. And an extra Gutter Runner. So I've got, sorry, Night Runner rather. So I've got 3 Night Runners now, including my champion. So my warband grows with... more rats and vermin and dudes. And you hired yourself 4 greatswords.
Yep.
Because that wasn't hard enough. Now I gotta fight there 4 dudes that are good at hitting things. Extra renown. Yeah. You could have gone, you could have just done a Griff Knight.
I could have done. Could have done a Demigriff. We went for 4 guys.
Next game, we're going Demigriff, I think.
Yeah.
All right, so it is at the end of the first mission. So we've managed to pull off. It's interesting because our warbands are roughly the same size still, even though like you've hired slightly better stuff, but we almost have the same number of models. And there it was, end of the game. We've basically done the Dawn attack, we've pushed towards Shadespire, and we've been driven off by some feeble humans there to try and find all the
stuff. One of our guys got
hurt. He did.
We left.
Slightly. We left him behind. We let him find another one.
Yeah.
Went off to the taverns that have like, because it's kind of like a boom town, like stuff's like growing up around the Shadespire. And what's neat is the new, the organized play one, the one that's going to be like the competitive game, is supposed to be based in Shadespire as well. So I'm kind of excited about that because I think when I paint those models for that game, they'll be really fun to play this with too. You know what I mean? Because you'll be able to play them in both as like little mini AOS armies. So anyway, both of us recruiting and adding some guys. You'll be able to see game 2, link below, on Gaming with the Cooler today. So just follow that link. You can hop on over and see our second game. And we'll keep doing these probably every 2 weeks or so until we get through all 6 games in the campaign. So hope you enjoyed that. We'll see you for more Age of Sigmar Skirmish in the future. Tonight I'm Ash, this is Owen. Happy Wargaming.